Well, thank you all for coming. This is the biggest room in Phillips Hall, and it looks like we have a good crowd, so I'm glad that you could all make it. We're here to talk about an issue that's been in the news a little bit. Not just been in the news, but been a little controversial as well. And I see politicians in this audience. I see students in this office, in this room. I see some realtors in this room. I see some faculty members in this room. And I see some industry people in this room. And for some reason, people care about this stuff right here. Sand. Who would have thought 10 years ago that UW-Eau Claire, Eau Claire, Wisconsin, would become the epicenter of something that they care about even in Norway, that they care about down in Houston, Texas, that they care about in Washington, D.C. They care about this stuff. This stuff is what is called frac sand. And what we're going to be talking about today is frac sand, not only the geology. We'll be talking a little bit about what makes Wisconsin sand special. We'll be talking a little bit about exploration strategies in different places where they are exploring for sand right now. We're going to talk about impacts and controversies associated with frac sand as well. So we're going to cover many different things. Now, of course, frac sand, there must be a use for it. And the use for this frac sand is to conduct a process that is called fracking, or hydraulic fracturing. This is a method that is used in the oil and gas industry to enhance gas and oil recovery. The basic idea is this: they can drill a hole down into an area of interest. And now they actually have the technology to switch from drilling vertically to drilling horizontally in the area where they want to get petroleum and natural gas. Once they have cased this hole, then they will blast some holes through that casing, and then they inject fluids and sand into this well under very high pressures. These pressures are sufficient to open up fractures, or here they're called fissures, within the rock. Now, when they open up these fractures, the sand grains go in there, and then when they depressurize and these fractures try to close up, at that point, those sand grains serve as pillars that prop open the fractures. Hence, sometimes these sands are called proppants. And as these fissures are kept open, even though they might only be half a millimeter in width, that is sufficient to allow oil and natural gas to come into the well much, much faster and enhance oil and natural gas recovery. This technology has allowed gas and oil companies to produce oil and natural gas out of units that previously were not possible. Well, this is kind of big news in the state of Wisconsin, especially in western Wisconsin. In fact, the Leader Telegram, they selected frac sand mining in western Wisconsin as their top news story. And this was the photo they had in this front page article. Well, so we care about this in western Wisconsin. Does anybody care about this outside of western Wisconsin? Well, maybe. Did any of you listen to the State of the Union address, where our president made a few statements that I found kind of interesting? He said, right now, American oil production is the highest that it's been in 8 years. Not only that, last year we relied less on foreign oil than in any of the past 16 years. Now that's an interesting statement. He doesn't mention fracking in there, but that is a statement about fracking. This one, the linkage is even more direct. It was public research dollars over the course of 30 years that helped develop the technologies to extract all this natural gas out of shale rock. When he says shale rock, shale gas, that people is fracking. Whether he mentions the name in a State of the Union address or not, that is fracking. Reminding us that government support is crucial in helping businesses get new energy ideas off the ground. So, Leader Telegram thinks it's important. The President of the United States says it's important. Then I guess we should maybe think that this is important as well. Our goal today is to try to better understand why they think this is so important and how this is impacting Wisconsin. Now, before I go on, I'd like to talk a little bit about my background because biases are important. First of all, I'm a glacial geologist by training. And just realize I'm not a professional sedimentologist, although in Madison I had lots of interactions with Dr. Bob Dott, who is kind of Mr. Cambrian Sandstone in Wisconsin. I've also been a consultant in the frac sand industry for about 3 years. The most important thing here is the last bullet here. My view is that everything has an impact. Everything has an impact. If you're going to talk to me about tourism, I'll tell you the impacts, the environmental impacts of tourism. If you're going to tell me about a new Kestrel plane manufacturing plant in Superior, I'll talk to you about the impacts of that. Everything has an impact. And frac sand mining is no different. It has an impact, both good and bad. So where does this story start? This story starts about 500 million years ago along the shores of an ancient ocean, when we had beaches and the waves were coming in and rounding these sand grains, depositing these very clean sands within the state of Wisconsin. These sands, this is a bedrock geologic map of the state of Wisconsin, and the ones we're most interested in are in this kind of yellowish unit here. These are sandstones that were deposited about 500 million years ago. Some of them are good for frac sand, others are not. Now, this was put together by the Wisconsin Center for Investigative Journalism, and these dots represent places where mines were either being proposed. I guess the green dots here are where they're active mines. This is from July, so this is way out of date. I don't know where to get an up-to-date map. I don't know that anybody can give you an up-to-date map. This is a big deal, however. This is a picture of the new EOG processing plant up in Chippewa Falls, which has been very, very controversial as well, if you've been listening to the news. But $60 million just in Chippewa County, in Chippewa Falls, that's a big, big investment. I estimate there might be $1 billion in investments going into mining infrastructure in the state of Wisconsin. And that's, don't quote me on that, but just if you have $60 million that's just in Chippewa Falls, and you look at all those things, this really counts up in a hurry. This is big stuff. And here, if we take a look at these dots, this is from the Leader Telegram. You look at these operating and approved mines here, these proposed mines, 16. This is back in July 2011. This is ancient history for frac sand, but that's about as good as you get right now. What are the economics driving this boom? Well, EOG, the Enron Oil and Gas, it was spun off before the big collapse of Enron. They estimate they're going to save about $500,000 per well by owning their own sand source. Well, $500,000 per well, that's a lot of money, but they drill many, many holes. They estimate that they're going to save $400 million per year by owning their own sand source. That is a huge, huge amount of money. Also, property owners can easily get royalty checks on the order of hundreds of thousands of dollars, even maybe in the low millions per year. This is big, big money, huge money. And for this reason, we have a sand boom that's going on in the state of Wisconsin. Now, what are they looking for with regard to sand sources? First of all, they want 100% quartz. And quartz is, later on we'll be talking about crystalline silica. Quartz is crystalline silica. And they want it to be 100% quartz because it doesn't react chemically with other things. Sphericity, they want grains that are perfectly spherical, ideally. That way, when they get into the fractures, it can't kind of twist and turn. And if it's a flat grain, then the fracture can pretty much close up. But if it's a spherical grain, that guarantees what the size of the fracture is going to be generated using a certain size sand. This is kind of a tale of a good sand and a bad sand. This is a horrendously bad sand. And look how angular that material is. By the way, I didn't test that sand. I never would have tested that sand, but I don't know who on earth got that report, but they were very sad. But if you look at this report, you see how nicely rounded those grains are and how they're almost spherical? That is beautiful. That is beautiful sand there on the right. Also, the grain size is critical. The grain sizes that most companies want would be in the so-called 2040 mesh size. What does that refer to? In order to determine sand sizes, they run the sand through these sieve shakers, and they're different size openings that are present there. And they use that to separate out the sand sizes. So the most valuable sand size is between 0.84 and 0.42 millimeters. That's what's called 2040 sand. That's worth a premium. The 4070 sand here, 0.42 to 0.21 millimeters. Then down here you get into the range, they don't really want that stuff. Also, they want a sand that does not have silt and clay associated with it. That is going, if you send something down a hole that has silt and clay in it, it can plug things up. And before they would ever do that, they'd have to wash that. And washing the stuff costs money. Costing money is bad. That adversely impacts the bottom line. Now, this is a tale of good sand and bad sand, once again. It's the same sands we saw before. 2040, that's the good stuff. 1.9% 2040, very sad, very sad. 50% 2040, that's pretty good. 3050, I mean, that this sand over here, it's running quite coarse, and that's what the sand companies want, because that can keep the fractures open as wide as possible to enhance that oil and gas recovery. Another thing that companies are looking for are very strong sands. They don't want something that is going to crush easily. So here, for example, here's our poor, woeful sand, 2,000 pounds per square inch. That's very sad sand. Over here, we have a sand that crushed at 9,000 pounds per square inch. The sands in the state of Wisconsin commonly crush between 7,000 and 9,000 PSI. These are some of the strongest sands in the world. And for that reason, Wisconsin sands can be sold at a premium. When I say Wisconsin, I also mean southeastern Minnesota, and I also mean northern Illinois. But here, we're talking about the Wisconsin frac sand boom, so don't think that we're the sole people who have this sand. Another thing that impacts the economic viability of frac sand is going to be the water table. Typically, companies will mine down to within 5 feet of the water table. There's only one company that I know of that is planning to mine below the water table. That's Uniman down near Sparta, Wisconsin. They're going to be creating a lake there eventually. But most of the companies, they want to just go down to right above the water table. This is important because even if you have a very good sand, frac sand target, if you have a high water table, virtually none of that sand is going to be accessible. If, on the other hand, you have a very low water table, then you can mine to within 5 feet of that, and therefore you can take more of the material out of the ground. Some other variables that impact frac sand economics: size of parcels. Most places don't want to deal with anything smaller than 100 acres. They don't want roads cutting across property parcels either. Roads on the outside are fine, but roads going through the middle, not so good. And all those other things are just fine. But if you have all those other things, but you don't have direct access to good transportation, then you can't get the sand to market anyway. So therefore, good transportation is critical. And direct access to that is important as well. Typically, county or state highways, very important. And being able to load to rail or barge, very important as well. Politics. Is politics important? You better believe it's important. And we'll be talking more about politics a little later. You might have read about the Wisconsin Supreme Court decision within the last 2 weeks. That's a huge, huge decision. And therefore, this political thing here is probably a little less settled now than it was 2 to 3 weeks ago. So, why is Wisconsin experiencing such a sand rush, gold rush, whatever you want to call it? We have high quality, strong sand, and it's near the surface. We also have a fairly good transportation network. So all of these things are at work. So now let's take a look at the geology of the sands and a little bit about what's going on in different places. This is a stratigraphic section for the state of Wisconsin put out by the Wisconsin Geological Survey last year. And these red arrows mark the units that could be potential frac sand units in the state of Wisconsin. The oldest of these units is what is called the Wonawoc Formation. And later on, I will be showing you some bedrock maps. And on those bedrock maps, the Wonawoc is going to be kind of a reddish color. Wonawoc Formation is typically a fine to medium grain sand. This is what they're mining up in Chippewa County and many places over in Menominee as well, down in Trempealeau County. A younger unit is something called the Jordan Formation. The Jordan Formation, it largely outcrops over toward the Mississippi River. The Jordan Formation is coarser grained than is the Wonawoc Formation. Another way of saying that is that the Jordan Formation runs higher in 2040 sand. It has more of that sweet sand that's more coarse that can be sold at a premium. So this Jordan Formation is considered the most attractive frac sand target in the state of Wisconsin, but its outcrop pattern makes it difficult to mine, difficult to find places where it can be mined economically. There's another unit that is being mined in the state of Minnesota largely, and in eastern Wisconsin as well. This is something called the St. Peter Sandstone, or the St. Peter Formation, named after St. Peter, Minnesota. This tends to be a very quartz-rich sand, but it's not as coarse as the Jordan. So therefore, this thing right here, this Jordan sandstone, is kind of the star of the show. But this Wonawoc has been producing great sand in the state of Wisconsin as well. Now, if we take a look at these distribution of mines here, this is Arcadia. Here we have Buffalo County. Here we have Black River Falls. Here's Whitehall. You can see all of these dots present there. And then you come up here into western Chippewa County, and you can see all of those dots present there as well. Why is that? Why do we have such a clumping, so to speak, of these dots? One of the reasons for that is because these areas are regions that were not glaciated most recently. Remember, I'm a glacial geologist, and they are trying to mine the sand where the glaciers didn't cover recently. So, for example, here is western Wisconsin. You see it has this kind of light blue pattern. This area with darker blue, this is where the glaciers got about 15 to 30,000 years ago. So out here, most of the old glacial deposits have eroded away. So you don't have to scrape that stuff out of the way in order to get at the frac sand. Down here in Trempealeau County, Buffalo County, Jackson County, this is in a part of the state called the Driftless Area, where the glaciers never reached. So there, you don't have to deal with any glacial overburden whatsoever. That's a big deal for sand companies, sand exploration. Another thing that's kind of interesting is you see this clumping pattern right here. Well, that's a strange pattern. And you see how it kind of connects up with this strange shaped part of Trempealeau County boundary? That's because there is a railroad that's running right up that river valley. So another thing that's extremely important is access to rail. So right here, this railroad right here is what has been driving the sand mines that have been opening down in Trempealeau, Jackson County. Up here we have a rail line going from Chippewa Falls up through Bloomer, New Auburn, and if you keep track, and here is a rail line that goes through Augusta, Maryland. If you follow frac sand news, you'll know all of those names. And it's not a coincidence that they coincide with railroads, because without rail or access to barge traffic, you can't get the product by the ton to the market in an economical fashion. Now, let's take a look at some of the places where big exploration and probably in the future production is going to be occurring. Let's take a look at Barron County, first of all. Barron County would be right up here. And what I'm showing you here, this is a map that was put out by the State Geological Survey in 1987. Person named Mike Mudry put out this map. Each one of these colors represents a different bedrock type that is exposed at the surface. Now, there are two stars that we're always going to be concerned about. This yellow-colored unit right here, that says CJ on it, that is the Jordan Formation. And remember, that was the most coarse-grained sand unit that we have in the state of Wisconsin that crushes well, that is largely quartz. And what you can see is up here in Barron County, there's lots of yellow up there. That means that it's right at the surface as long as it's not buried by glacial material. And this big pile of yellow sitting there has been driving a lot of exploration in southern Barron County, outside of the area that was glaciated most recently. So, light yellow Jordan Formation. This red unit right here, this is the Wonawoc Formation. And what you can see is that the Wonawoc Formation here is just kind of outcropping in a narrow sort of a pattern. That means that it's not as easy to get at. You can't mine huge areas with that. But still, that's another potential target in the Barron County, Dunn County area. Let's take a look at Trempealeau, Jackson County area. Now, when you look at that map, how does it look different? What color just knocks you out? Red, red, red. And what unit is that? Wonawoc Formation. So down here is Blair, here's Whitehall. And what we see in northern Trempealeau County, We have Wonawoc Formation that's exposed all over the place. This has been mined by Badger Mining for decades. Wind Sand, which was just sold to Preferred Sand, that's in this unit as well. So here we have a picture of Wonawoc Formation that's driving exploration in those areas. Eau Claire County. Any controversies about frac sand in Eau Claire County? Absolutely. Here's Eau Claire, Wisconsin. Here's a rail line. Oh, there's Augusta. And what do you see right here? You see little patches of red. What are they going after? Wonawoc Formation. Why are they going after it here? There's the railroad. Chippewa, Dunn counties. Chippewa County was kind of the place where things started first. And what we can see here in Chippewa County, we have these narrow Wonawoc patches. Then we have these little patches of Jordan every once in a while. Largely the mining up there has been associated with Wonawoc Formation. Where does the rail come? Bloomer, New Auburn, and then up to the north. So, with regard to exploration, and recognize that this talk is for geology majors too. This is for the Earth Science Seminar Series. So there are many geology majors who are in this. So this next slide is kind of for the geology majors of the crew. If you're going to explore for sand, what kind of info can you use? Newspaper articles. Let me tell you, I read the newspaper, and you can get some wonderful information out of the newspapers. Bedrock maps from the State Geological Survey, well logs from DNR, from the Wisconsin Geological Survey, reclamation plans for mines. They have useful geologic information. Plat books that show property ownership. All of these things are valuable sources of information that can be used in the office. But office work can only go so far. Eventually, you need to get out in the field and take a look at the stuff. Maybe get an excavator, dig a hole, and see what the sand looks like. Collect the sand, ship it out for testing to see how well it crushes, for example, how strong it is. See how good the grain size of the material is. And then, after going through that entire process, then at that point, if a company decides to develop a site, then they need to hire some sort of engineering consulting firm to produce a reclamation plan to satisfy the requirements for non-metallic mining in the state of Wisconsin. This area, SEH up in Chippewa County in Chippewa Falls, has been doing just an immense number of these NR-135 reports. Also, there will be a public hearing on this reclamation plan. If a company is going to move forward, they also have to be thinking about infrastructure needs, washing the material. They can't afford to have any silt and clay associated with that. They're going to wash that sand. That requires large amounts of water. And it also requires three-phase electricity, a drying plant that needs natural gas, and not just a little natural gas either. You need to have a big, big supply of natural gas and electricity as well. Also need some sort of rail loading facility. All of these things need to come, they need to fall into place, or else you cannot get your material to market in a timely fashion. Now, if a company decides that they want to put in a mine, well, great, right? Well, that's a controversial sort of thing. This is part of a full-page ad in the Leader Telegram that ran about a week and a half ago, I believe. And to the citizens of Eau Claire County, citizens for a sand moratorium. If you've been watching the news over the last 4 months, it's been moratorium in the news almost constantly. Right now, the county of Eau Claire is under a 6-month moratorium. that will expire, I believe, in April. Dunn County recently enacted a one-year moratorium, I believe, that will, it just started in January. So there's big controversy associated with frac sand, but I mean, this seems like a pretty nice thing. I mean, we can mine sand, we can sell it. What's the controversy? Well, because there are impacts. There are impacts. Remember, everything has an impact. So what are some impacts and political controversies associated with frac sand mining? Well, mining isn't the prettiest thing in the world. It really isn't. You might take an area that had nice trees on that hillside, and then you take off those trees to expose the sandstone. No, that's, in my view, that's not as pretty as it used to be. Could also impact wildlife. Noise. Mining is a noisy operation. And it's not just the mining that leads to noise, but there's commonly truck traffic associated with the mining as well. And the truck traffic, it's not just truck traffic generating noise, but these trucks are heavy. And these heavy trucks, that exerts a toll on the road. So there's no question that mining sand and taking it over roads can lead to road degradation. Now, some places such as Chippewa County, I don't know if any of you are from Chippewa County, and you might know Dan Masterpole up there, associated with Land Conservation Department. Dan Masterpole went from having a job where he was land conservationist in a sleepy sort of a county to a county where he was on the front lines of something, and this had never been done before in the state of Wisconsin. It was a scale previously not seen before, and Dan Masterpole and his crew up in Chippewa County have done just a wonderful job of trying to protect the interests of the people of Chippewa County up there, as well as working with companies so that they are able to accomplish their business up there as well. It's kind of like walking a tightrope. I feel sorry for him in so many ways, but he's a great man to be in that position, highly capable. So the truck traffic is a big deal up there. They've actually negotiated road agreements where companies are putting many thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands of dollars into an account that is going to be used not only to pay for road damage, but in some cases to upgrade these roads to state highway standards so that they do not degrade as quickly. Another potential impact would be associated with the washing of the sand. These plants washing the sand are typically not on city water. They're out in a rural area, so they need high capacity wells in order to take the water out of the ground. If they pump too fast, then the groundwater might not be able to recharge as fast, so the water table might go down. That could potentially cause people's wells adjacent to the mine to dry up. Is that a big deal? That's a huge deal. Flocculants used for removing clay. Recognize let's just say that this is a transparent cup and I have some clay that's present in there, and then there's some water, and I shake that up. And you look at that water and it just looks kind of gross. How fast is clay going to settle out of that water? Not very, because those particles are so small. So many companies will use something called a flocculant. It's a chemical. When you put it in the water, it causes the clay particles to stick to that flocculant. And therefore, those big stuck together clumps will settle out much faster. What's the benefit to that? Most companies want to recycle their water. Instead of constantly pumping new water out of the ground, they want to recycle the water, but that water cannot have clay within it. By using these flocculants, they can get rid of that clay faster so they can recycle more water, pump less water out of the ground, and less potential lowering on the water table. Well, that's good, right? Everything can have an impact. So, for example, the most common flocculant used is something called polyacrylamide. Polyacrylamide is something that is just a benign substance. It is manufactured from something called acrylamide, which is not a benign substance. And within polyacrylamide, there can be trace amounts of contamination of this stuff right here associated with that polyacrylamide. Well, this acrylamide, monoacrylamide as it's sometimes called, this is a nasty. It causes nerve disorders, I believe. So if that gets into the groundwater, that could be a bad thing. But the good thing is, how long does it last in the environment? How long does it persist? It has an environmental persistence of about 14 days. 14 days. So that means that if it's in the water or if it's in the soil, it will get eaten up and it will change into carbon dioxide and methane gas in about 14 days. That's very, very important because it means it's not going to stick around forever like PCBs and DDT do. So that short environmental persistence is a very important thing, but even if it will persist for 2 weeks, might it be possible for water to get from the settling pond to an adjacent well in 2 weeks so somebody is drinking that stuff? Could be. That's something that needs to be studied. You can't just out of hand discount that. But if a company can do anything, such as lining the settling ponds, anything to hold that back, then that material is going to break down fast. Well, it's just going to break down more on the site as opposed to breaking down as it might be moving off-site toward potentially somebody's well. I also saw for a while in the paper that it only creates poor jobs, i.e. truckers. And that is just blatantly false. That is blatantly false. In the geology department at UW-Eau Claire, we have about 6 students right now who are working in the frac sand industry, and every day more interview in the frac sand industry. I know of one student who was hired before he even graduated, and he was hired starting at $50,000 a year with benefits. That is not a bad job. If that is a bad job, that's making more than some PhDs make in UW-Eau Claire. And if a person with a 4-year degree is making more than a PhD in UW-Eau Claire, my question would be, why is the state of Wisconsin running a sweatshop? Why doesn't the state of Wisconsin generate good jobs? A little political commentary there. I have the right to vent, all right? It's been a bad year. All right. So, they're not poor jobs. There are electricians necessary. There are engineers necessary. There are chemists necessary. There are plumbers necessary. There are public health officers that are necessary. And there's truckers. They need truckers too. Oh, that's bad. Let me tell you, not everybody is going to get a degree in geology or engineering. We need jobs for people who are not going to be professionals as well. Personally, I'd rather have people driving a truck than on the welfare rolls. We need jobs in the state of Wisconsin. So this, I would say, really hasn't been in the news very much lately, and that's good because there are good jobs that are available in this industry. Now, if you look at this list right here, all these impacts and stuff like that, there's something missing there. There's something missing. What is it? What's missing? I heard it. Air quality. Air quality and silicosis. This has probably been the biggest thing in the news recently. Let's talk a little bit about that. One thing that has been put out in the press and has been spoken of in letters to the editor just time and time again is the possibility of a public outbreak of silicosis from sand mining. Let's talk about that. Silicosis, what is it? This is a definition from NIOSH. A disabling, often fatal lung disease caused by breathing dust with very small particles of respirable crystalline silica. What does that mean? Respirable means breathable. Has to get into your lungs. And what does that mean? Less than 4 microns. So, in order to get silicosis, we're very, very concerned about this very, very fine fraction of crystalline silica. And remember, these sandstones, quartz, is crystalline silica. So this is something to think about. And there's no question that silicosis is an occupational risk. People who work in an occupational environment where there's lots of crushed silica, that might be a sand mine, that might be cutting tiles, that might be out with a jackhammer blasting apart concrete. It might involve sandblasting a bridge or sandblasting a cathedral. Those people have a definite risk of silicosis because they're exposed to elevated levels of this crystalline silica, and it's not just one day, it's 5 days a week for an extended period of time. Silicosis is something to be concerned about, especially if you are working in one of those occupations. Now, the problem I have is this. The public health risk is a different matter. It's another matter. I've seen people citing articles about environmental silicosis, and one of those articles was published in 1991 by some people working in northern India on the Tibetan Plateau, an area that is very high and does not have vegetation, and they have killer dust storms there. Not only that, but the people were cooking in shacks that some of which didn't even have chimneys associated with them, and they measured the crystalline silica in the dust within these cooking areas, and they're basically industrial levels of crystalline silica in the air. Another article about Bedouins in the Negev Desert, and once again, they're a very dry area, no vegetation, and cooking in areas where there's commonly lots of dust and poor ventilation. Now, we need to talk a little bit about particle sizes. This circle right here represents a sand grain of 0.21 millimeters. That's number 70 mesh sand. This is 210 microns. This is the finest sand grain that a company would want to mine. And actually, they want something that's twice as large as that. That's what they want, but they don't always get it. This grain right here is a grain at the sand-silt boundary that's 62.5 microns. Now, this particle right here is 4 microns. That would be the respirable particle size. It's down in the silt fraction. And just for reference here, an average human hair, about thickness of approximately 100 microns. This is a very, very small particle, but this could potentially be generated during a sand mining operation. Now, I don't want you to read that. I'm going to read it to you. But this is, I would say, a pretty typical letter to the editor. It's from the Rice Lake Chronotype, which is one of my favorite newspapers. The Eau Claire Leader Telegram and the Rice Lake Chronotype, man, don't leave home without it. They're really good. Now, this was a reader blog from 3 January 2012. So don't look at this. I'll just read it to you. In reading the comments from the online version of the Chronotype, I think there is a need to explain just what all the fuss is concerning frac sand and citizens' health. This is a very simplistic explanation of the issues, an exposure to silica dust 101, if you will. So here's her statement. And by the way, I agree with her statement here, except for about the where. Well, we'll talk about that later. So, continuing. The round, hard grains of sand themselves are not the issue. The problems are the particles that hold that sand together, forming our landscape. An easy explanation is that the glue that holds the sand grains together is the danger. As this sandstone is broken apart, the crystalline silica dust is now free to be blown miles away from the mine or processing plant. This is the reason for air quality programs from the DNR and other federal agencies. So I guess I agree with this entire paragraph here. The problem I have with her up here, this is a very simplistic explanation of the issues. Actually, I agree with that too. That is a very simplistic explanation of the issues. And let's take a look at that. Let's take a look at exposure to silica dust 201 now. All right, here we're looking at a sandstone. Here you can see these individual grains of sand. These are made out of crystalline silica. They're very small. They're very strong. If you look at these sandstones that they're interested in mining, typically they have virtually no cement in them at all. I can take one of these sandstones and I can just rip it apart in my hand and shatter it. And look how skinny I am. I'm not strong. So most of these sandstones do not have much cement in them to start with, but still, she made a valid point. These small, or I should call them large actually, these large quartz grains, that's not where the action is with regard to particulate matter, crystalline silica. It's these things right here. The cement or glue that is holding the grains together. Now, if this glue is made out of crystalline silica, that is a wonderful place. That is a wonderful place to get crystalline silica dust in the respirable fraction. If, on the other hand, this cement is made out of something else other than silica, then that's a different matter. Well, what evidence do we have for the cement in the rocks present in the state of Wisconsin? Well, actually, in the state of Wisconsin, we don't have good information. But just across the border, Thomas, in 1991, he published a very detailed petrographic study, a rock study of the Jordan Formation. And what he reported is that the cement is dominated by calcium carbonate. 20% of the rock, in many cases, was made out of calcium carbonate, which is the stuff of limestone. And most commonly, the Jordan Formation did not have any crystalline silica in the cement. There were some exceptions. There were some samples that ran maybe 1 to 2% crystalline silica in the cement. And then he had one sample that was 24% crystalline silica, which pretty much just cemented the entire rock together, made it so hard it you wouldn't even be able to mine that stuff. The composition of the cement is incredibly, incredibly important. If in the state of Wisconsin that is crystalline silica, then that can be a major source of crystalline airborne silica. We don't know. This is something that a geologist studies. This is a study just waiting to happen, and this summer I'm hoping to do a research project with UW-Eau Claire undergrad geology students to see what this glue is. And if it's the same as what they've reported over in Minnesota, this is a game changer, because this would then say that the crystalline silica would have to come from the breaking up of these big grains, which is a very difficult thing to do compared to shattering the glue. I don't know what the result will be, but whatever the result is, it should be interesting. So, oh man, Mayors. This is for geology majors. I ran a spell check, so I don't think that's a word though. So, if you want to get a job in frac sand, what should you be doing? Read the news. Read the news. The Eau Claire Leader Telegram, that's a good source of information. Google can be a good source of information as well. But keep up on the news. Know your Paleozoic stratigraphy, the local stratigraphy. Know it. Be able to articulate a knowledge of variables that impact frac sand mining. Don't just pretend that geology is everything. It is not. There's politics. There's all this other stuff that's very important as well. Know about that stuff. Be able to speak. If you're working for a frac sand firm, I assure you, you're going to be talking to a lot of people, and they're not going to be comfortable conversations in many cases. You better have good oral communication skills. Be able to think about what a client needs. Be able to have good GIS skills, good field skills. Be able to get good recommendations. Show that you can bring a project to completion. I mean, you could say the same about any job, right? Be smart. Network. Don't slack off, because every time people are watching, all the time people are watching you. Now, I get questions from people, how long will this industry last? Well, first of all, if these big companies are putting out this much money to come into Western Wisconsin, they're not planning to leave tomorrow. Some people compare, well, up in Ladysmith, when they mined massive sulfides, they were there 2 to 3 years and then they were gone. There's no way these companies are thinking about 2 or 3 years and leaving. That would not be a good business plan. That is evidence they're planning on sticking around. Also, as long as we use oil and natural gas, I believe there's going to be a market for Wisconsin frac sand. We have some of the strongest sand out there. And if there's a shakeout in the frac sand industry, I believe that our mines here have a much better chance of surviving than some mine down in Texas, where they're getting sands that might have half the crush strength. And also, quite frankly, I don't see us going away from an oil and natural gas economy anytime soon. Plastics, heating, transportation, I just do not see us getting away from that anytime soon. To show you my age, I think it was back in, what was it, 1980, John B. Anderson. He ran on a platform of raising the gasoline tax to encourage conservation. What a good idea, right? That's before I could vote, and I supported John B. Anderson. I thought that was a great idea. Nobody else did. Nobody else did. I don't see us weaning ourselves from this oil and natural gas addiction anytime soon, people. And if somebody tells you they have a magic bullet for electric cars, oh great, you plug in your car to a coal-burning power plant. There is a good idea, an idea that'll really sell. You know, it's just, everything has an impact, and there's no magic pill. You pick your poison. You pick your poison. And right now, we're poisoning the atmosphere with CO2, and I don't see that changing anytime soon. I really don't. Based on those things, duration of this industry, I believe that if I'm still living here 30 years from now, I'm going to see sand mines here. That's what I believe, because I think that this is a durable sort of an industry. So, conclusions. Impacts of sand mining in Wisconsin? Absolutely. Absolutely. There are negative impacts associated with sand mining. There are positive impacts as well. I would say that most of the negative aspects are solvable by hydrogeologists, engineers, proper agreements as well. I'd say that most of those things are solvable. Here at the geology department, UW-Eau Claire, this is what we train people to do. We train people to solve problems. We have people who go through our program and then maybe they transfer to the U of M and they get an engineering degree and a geology degree from here. These people are trained in order to solve problems. Impact of not mining sand in Wisconsin? Yes, absolutely. If we do not mine sand in the state of Wisconsin, our economy is not going to be as diversified. We're not going to have the same type of jobs. Eau Claire, city of Eau Claire, its economy, hospitals are huge. Have you seen what the federal budget looks like lately? What is going to happen in Eau Claire when the federal government no longer reimburses the hospitals with the same amount of money? What's going to happen to those hospitals? That's not going to be a good thing. What's happening to the university right now in university budgets? Let me tell you, it's not a good thing. What's happening to corn prices? Corn prices are high. Yes! And if corn prices are always $6 to $7 a bushel, that's a great thing for Wisconsin farmers. But everything comes and goes. What happens when it goes down to $1.50 a bushel? That's bad for Wisconsin farmers. That's bad for the economy of the state of Wisconsin. Personally, I believe the benefits of frac sand mining outweigh the negatives. And just to illustrate that, I'm going to close with a personal story. I'm from northern Minnesota. In an area that would be very similar to Sawyer County, Wisconsin, a lake district. When I graduated from high school, there were 45 students in my senior class, and just about everyone left. Nobody stuck around. Why is that? There were no jobs. There were no jobs whatsoever. Virtually all my class, I could find them living in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. Those people who leave and never come back, their kids are not going through the high school and elementary schools where I grew up. Those people aren't buying groceries at the local grocery stores. They're not buying gas at the local place. They're not eating at the local restaurants. Those people are gone. And they come back and visit every once in a while. It seems to me that we really need to evaluate this seriously. And personally, I have kids. I would love for them to be able to get a job in the state of Wisconsin and not have to move to the Twin Cities. I really don't like the Twin Cities. And, you know, I have three sisters who live in the Twin Cities. But, you know, it's just, my blood pressure goes up whenever I go to the Twin Cities. I'd prefer to stay as far away from the Twin Cities as I can. But let me tell you, we need to be concerned about jobs. The university has to be concerned about preparing educated people to go out in the workforce. And we can do that. We can do that. But if the jobs are not there, where are the people going to go? They will go elsewhere. And I know that from personal experience, just from where I grew up. So when I say I believe the benefits outweigh the negatives, that's kind of where I'm coming from. I saw what's happened to my hometown, and it's not a pretty, pretty thing. So that's all I have to say. Thank you very much for your attention.
We certainly have time for questions. Jim.
Thanks, Phil. Thanks, Kent.
Sure.
I view particle sizes a little bit differently as an atmospheric chemist than as a geologist.
Sure.
I'm curious, you showed the great graphic of the large particle and the smaller particles.
Yep.
You also showed a table that showed the fractional composition by size of
yes.
the sand.
Yep.
I presume that's a mass percentage, correct?
That is correct.
So as an atmospheric chemist, when I think about particle size distributions, I think in terms of density perception, density or number distributions.
Yep.
Do you have any information on the number of ultrafine sand particles in the formations? Because if from a human health standpoint, I would argue that's actually far more significant than the mass fraction.
The number in the sandstones would be different than the number going to the plant, because you're going to be shattering that cement. And I firmly believe that the cement is really where the action is. So as far as the numbers of particles that are present in there, no, I do not. But the deal is this. The processing is a wet processing. So they bring this to the sites, and then they are washing the material. When they're washing the material, then that is going out to the settling pond. So when you're talking about as an atmospheric scientist, you're concerned about the stuff that's up in the atmosphere. Because it is a wet process, that is going to greatly reduce the potential of these small particulates getting up into the atmosphere. The material would typically, what will happen is that they'll typically use some dynamite to blast very, very small loads for it compared to really strong rocks. And then typically that will be carried by conveyor belt to their wash facility there. There might be, depending on the mine, there might be areas where they could store that in some sort of a pile present there, where it could still have the fine particulate matter present there. That would be a source of fugitive dust, for example. Therefore, you would need to keep that watered and stuff like that. But also, if you have a big pile of that material, then it is just the skin of that pile that is available to the wind. And not only that, but you also have these big grains that are acting as shields to kind of protect the material from being as mobile. So they're definite sources of particulate material, absolutely. But also, you know that as wind carries things, it will have a dispersive effect as well. So it isn't going to, if you have material that is leaving the site, as you move each kilometer away from that, there is going to be a dispersive effect as that is moving along as well.
Yes.
Just briefly, Dr. Syverson, I'm a resident landowner in the town of Bridge Creek, which of course is the town around Augusta.
Absolutely.
I simply want to, because I'm largely ignorant of this, but I'm not anymore. I want to thank you for a lively and informative lecture, and I particularly want to compliment you for being forthcoming about your connections to the industry and the connections of your students. That's much appreciated, so thank you.
Oh, sure.
Well, it's just, one thing that I learned when I was a freshman in college in a history course was my teacher was talking, and he said, you know, the scholars of the New Left say that the U.S. Constitution was a huge failure because it postponed the rise of socialism in the United States. It's like, wow, that's amazing to me. I thought our Constitution was all right. But what that told me is that bias is really important. That's whenever I talk, I want to make sure that people do know my bias. I do have an iron in the fire. I have an iron in the fire, not just for me, but especially for my students. It's going to make a much bigger impact on my students than it is on me. Because pretty soon I won't be useful to anybody. All these mining companies, they'll already have their sand sources, but it's going to be my students who are going to be working in those mines, working in those processing plants. Yes?
Do you discuss the ethics of the frack drilling, the end result of the frack sand mining?
Do I?
Yeah.
Sure, I'll talk about that. Are there impacts associated with fracking? Absolutely. Do I think they probably will regulate shallow fracking? Yeah, probably. Is that a good thing? Probably. If you're fracking right adjacent to a groundwater aquifer, is that a good thing? No, that's not. But I would also say that extracting oil and natural gas, whether you frack or not, It's a messy process. It really is, because what you have is you have these hydrocarbons that are out there. If you have a pipeline and it breaks and that stuff gets out, you don't want that stuff to get out. The entire purpose of our petroleum industry is to try and free it up and get it moving. That is a messy process. It's not as messy as it was 30 years ago. It's a messy process. I think we will see regulation of shallow fracking in the future. Deep fracking, I think that it's going to be here. As oil and gas prices go up, there will be more incentive to frack things like crazy.
We have two more questions over here.
Yes. Yeah. I didn't hear something there.
Okay, in Clark County, I'm with Southern Clark County.
Yes.
And there, we get mining deposits on our faucets in the water, in the rural water system.
Okay.
Up here in Chippewa County, you don't get that. In 15 to 20 years, copper tubing is ate up and you've got leaking pipes.
Mm-hmm.
Faucets, kitchen faucet lasts about 3 years and the top grows off. Mm. Our water pH is 5.6.
Okay.
Now, if that's many materials, calcium carbonate or lime,
mm-hmm.
we would not have that problem, would we? Because that water should be up in the low 7.2 pH, and we're at 5.6. So that tells me, that I suspect there's not much calcium carbonate in that deposit. We're drawn from the Wanawak formation.
Okay. In all honesty, I suspect there isn't much cement in those period. But based on the weakness of those, when you get silica cement, that makes the rock a lot tougher. So I suspect it's not silica cement either. I don't know what I'm going to find with regard to the cement up there, but wouldn't you want to know?
Yeah, I want you to find out.
Yeah.
I got a hunch what you're going to find. But.
Well, I don't think it's going to be dominated by silica, just based on the weakness, the low strength of the material. But rainwater is naturally acidic, but not anywhere down near 5. You said 5.5?
5.6 is what most of the wells run that.
5.6?
In our area.
5.6? That's pretty low.
Yes, so
I don't know. That's an interesting thing. But we'll find out.
You missed one impact on there, two.
Could be.
I think the long-range impact that hasn't been talked about, the loss of productive ag land for future generations.
Well, I'm not sure about that. After these things are mined, they will be reclaimed. Will it be as productive as it was before? I would say no. It will not be as productive, at least for a while. Many of these areas that are being mined are also some pretty steep areas that are not necessarily the best things to mine anywhere where you can get high rates of soil erosion and stuff like that. So what you say might be the case, but I'm not convinced. I think there will be an adverse impact, but I will also say that the percentage of the land that we're talking about is going to be a very small percentage. People talk about all the hills being mined away in the state of Wisconsin, and that is not going to happen. Why? Because transportation would not allow it. So will there be some loss of productive ag land? Absolutely. Will it be a significant loss of productive ag land? In my opinion, no, but people can disagree.
But when you get to the density that we have up in the town of Auburn, the town of Cooks Valley, we're looking at the end of the year, we're thinking in the neighborhood of 4,000 to 5,000 acres impacted by mining, and I would suspect when you get out 10, 15 years, you're gonna be talking easily 3-4 times that much.
Possibly.
You're gonna have the same scenario you have in northern Minnesota right now, is nobody's gonna stay in the area because there's no way to generate a living in that area.
Well, I don't know if I agree with you on that. And the reason for that, I've spent a lot of time in Chippewa County because I mapped the glacial geology of Chippewa County. In 3 years, I spent three entire summers in Chippewa County. When I talked to farmers, they were pretty depressed, quite frankly, because they were land poor. They had this land, but they told me they didn't want their kids to take over the farm because they viewed it as a ball and chain. Now, corn wasn't $6, $7 an acre, or a bushel at that time, granted. But at that time, those farmers, they felt trapped. And I interacted with many of them as I sought permission to drill and permission to go on their property.
What years was that?
98 to 2000. 98 to 2000. Places such as eastern Chippewa County are not necessarily the most economically robust right now. I would argue that parts of Barron County are not overly economically robust either. And that's in spite of having excellent farming land there. Some of those areas, yes, and some not as good. So sandy soil, right?
A lot of rocks, too.
There can be. If the price of corn, the price of milk crater, those farmers have a problem. Those communities have a problem. If they can get some diversification of their economies, I would view at least those are some people who could stick around. Are there going to be impacts, sir? Yes, there will. I agree with you. There will be impacts, absolutely. The thing I'm most concerned about is truck traffic, quite frankly. It's truck traffic. That's a big deal. What are the chances of somebody dying of a public outbreak of silicosis? Very low. What is the probability of somebody, a kid who's late going to a volleyball game, who races out to the end of the driveway and turns on County Highway B, and they do not stop and they look? What are the odds of them getting hit by a sand truck? Pretty good. That is a fact. And that's a huge issue. That's a huge, huge issue. But it seems to me that there have been some people who have been trying to play up some impacts that I just don't think are very real, whereas some impacts, such as the traffic, they're very real. Very real.
There's been wild speculation on both sides of the issue. I'll be the first to admit that.
I'll agree.
We're going to continue with the chain of questions here, but I want everybody to feel comfortable to get up and leave. Don't feel like you're trapped here. So first, we're going to go here. One, two, then Karen. Yep.
I'm from Eastern Kentucky, from Appalachia, where coal has been extracted since 1900.
Yep.
And you can overlay the richest coal seams and then the poorest counties in America. And certainly we've seen that road destruction.
Yep.
We've seen mountaintop removal now.
Yep.
And now, sort of the final thing is probably the fracking for the natural gas that is destroying the water.
Mm-hmm.
But what about Wisconsin would make you more optimistic about the economic benefits of an extractive industry? And is there something about the tax structure that might deal with the unreplaceable things that are withdrawn?
The tax structure in Wisconsin is horrendously bad. I mean, in northern Minnesota, each ton of iron ore that's taken out, they tax that, and then it will go to, and on the iron range, there's this fund that's been used to fund startups and stuff like that, to fund schools. It's been a big deal. We do not have that for non-metallic mining in the state of Wisconsin, and personally, I think that is a mistake. Why do I think that frac sand mining would be different than coal mining? One thing is scale. I mean, you take a look at those coal mines. They are huge, huge, huge compared to what we're talking about here. As far as the economy, did you say West Virginia?
Kentucky.
So as far
matter, we could
That's right. That's right. So in those poorest areas, I would argue that they probably had a one industry beast that was present there. And as soon as coal started going downhill, there wasn't really another horse in the race, so to speak. That would help those areas tremendously. Do I believe that frac sand is going to become the driver of the economy in Eau Claire County or in Wisconsin? No, it never will be the driver of the economy. Will it be a diversifier? Yes. Right now, we're a net exporter of our money to places such as Texas, Wyoming, all these places where they get oil and natural gas. We are a huge, huge importer of these sorts of things. If we do frac sand, this is actually a way for us to be in the energy business kind of indirectly. And it's a way for us to kind of balance the books. We have a huge trade deficit with regard to energy. Is it going to be the driver here? No. Could it make a positive difference? Yes. Especially in some smaller places where they might not have too many options that are available with regard to jobs. Good question.
Karen?
Karen.
If people would go to the Energy Information Administration website, they project the amount of natural gas we're going to be consuming from shale into the future, let's say by 2050.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty significant.
Yeah.
And I think to suggest that there won't be a lot of impacts on the landscape of Wisconsin, given what the demand is indicating, I think is not accurate. And so I don't think it's appropriate to sit here and indicate that let's not worry about the loss of land, when if you look at the figures and the level of consumption now and where we're going to go, it's only going up.
Oh, it is.
And
yeah.
Because of challenges to zoning, as a community, we can't really even plan. We can't say, let's put the mines here versus there due to impacts,
mm-hmm.
because we don't have the power to interfere with people's rights mm-hmm. to develop their property and make a profit.
Mm-hmm.
So we're kind of stuck in mm-hmm. terms of whether the community can have a big impact on how these lands are going to be used. But we're especially stuck given the fact that we're doing the same old energy drumbeat. We're going to go after the non-renewables.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to open up our landscape to more sand mining.
Yep.
And we're going to dismiss carbon buildup in the atmosphere. We're going to dismiss some of these big impacts that are happening because
yeah.
of energy policy.
Yeah.
I think it's unfair to suggest that over time the impacts are going to be minimal on the landscape and the potential loss of carbon. I don't think the data should
well.
Be suggesting that. And if you just want to use anecdotal data, which is what you've used in a lot of your presentation,
mm-hmm.
look at the number of permits that are being mm-hmm. requested at this point.
Oh,
in time.
Yeah.
It's a lot.
There are many, many permits.
So,
but even when you talk about a large mine up in town of Auburn, what is that, 1,200 acres? Is that what they're talking about up there?
Yeah, that's a large one right now.
Yeah, so 1,200 acres. So that is 1,200 acres, that's 2 square miles. Well, 2 square miles, yeah, that's a lot of land, but if you compare that to the amount of land, and it's not all going to be open at one time, they will be reclaiming as they go.
Unless we specify the quality of the reclamation, how these operations are gonna proceed, you're speculating. That's not necessarily proven data that says this is how folks will behave. So I think it's really critical for everybody to understand. We know a lot of good information.
Mm-hmm.
There's still a lot that we're not sure about.
Absolutely.
We set up mining monitoring devices to figure out if we even need to worry about silicosis. And we can say, oh, the particles aren't the right size. Oh, we're going to water down those sand mines. But the truth of the matter is we don't know. And until we do some solid analysis of the data, of the demand for natural gas, of the conversion of electricity plants from coal to natural gas, you can't really speculate on the direction this is going to go.
Yeah.
I think you're downplaying some of these impacts.
That's
my opinion.
Well, that's okay. You can have your opinion and I'll have mine. I do not dispute that this is going to have an impact on the land. But it isn't all going to be an open gash in the ground all at one time. As far as the quality of the reclamation, I honestly believe that when you drive by these places 15 years after they've been reclaimed and they've planted trees or something like that on them, you're not going to be able to recognize that unless you really know what the land looked like beforehand.
You're speculating. You're suggesting we can plant trees and put grass on these things and life goes on. That, we don't know. We
you
just don't know.
Well, in eastern Kentucky, it hasn't happened.
Well, and once again, there you're kind of when you're talking about the big scale of things. I would argue you're kind of comparing apples and oranges.
No.
It is a huge scale out there, and it is different than what we're talking about here.
A scale that benefited stockholders in New York and not.
Well, there were miners who were employed who did make money while they were in business, but they and you know some of those underground miners, especially in West Virginia, they paid a huge health cost as well.
We bought their lungs, you know, for mm-hmm. to keep our lights on. We mm-hmm. paid benefits for those lungs.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right. I just wanted to say that I live in Pepin County.
And, yeah.
In our township, we get $130,000 a year to repair roads.
Mm-hmm.
We have 62 miles of roads, and mm-hmm. $130,000 will actually build, for comparison's sake, a half a mile.
Mm-hmm.
So there's not a lot of money for the road issue thing.
Yeah.
And another thing is the landscape, that a lot of us live there not just for the farming but because of the beauty.
Absolutely.
And we're restoring land and
yeah.
And there's a lot of natural ecosystems there.
Yeah.
And when you're talking about mining on these steep hillsides, that's where a lot of these rare plants and endangered mm-hmm. species are left.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's in the soils that they use to reclimate, a lot of that is dead soil in essence because it's pushed off to the side. And those soil biota, all the living organisms in that soil promote the living organisms that grow on that soil. So when you stockpile that soil, it in essence somewhat, to some extent, dies. So when you put that back on and then replant, you're not getting, you don't have the diversity within the soil anymore. You lose the diversity on the soil and in essence lose the diversity of the animals that would live on that, on those plants. And I hate to see in our area,
mm-hmm.
see that loss of diversity,
mm-hmm.
you know, in these sites.
Oh, sure. Yeah, yeah. And I think, why don't we take Nick, and then we should call it quits here. I'll hang around here to ask.
There were other people here.
Were they?
Well, there's a line of questions.
Well, I think we pretty much need to, we can't let this go on forever. But was there one other question, and then who is next? Do you know?
Is over here. Yeah.
Jeremy?
I guess I'm trying to think of what I can take away from this.
Sure.
You know, and I read your editorials in the Leader Telegram, Dunn County News, et cetera. And
yep.
I was trying to get an idea of what a fair way to think about your position is. So let me know if you agree with this in any way.
No.
All right, here we go. So you don't think that we can really do anything as citizens with regard to climate change, dependence on fossil fuel, and there, but you feel personally, like at least that you can't do anything about that.
Oh, I disagree with that. I walked here today.
Well,
I walked here today, and I made a choice to live close to my work, and Karen, you see me bike and walk, and and I'm also not a convenience food person. I do believe that there are things we can do. But do I believe that I'm going to see American society come around to the way I believe anytime soon? Not a chance. Not a chance. I don't see that anytime soon.
Basically, your message is that you're cynical of.
I am
of
cynical. I am.
Happening.
I'm cynical because I don't believe there's a magic bullet. Because if we do wind energy, we're killing birds.
Okay, so that was one half of my conclusion of what you were what you've been thinking and what you've expressed.
I'm cynical, absolutely.
The other half of it is you feel that there is something you can do to help geology students find jobs.
Yep.
And obviously that is your self-interest and your expertise area.
Sure.
I would like to do something about climate change and about fossil fuel dependence in my life at some point.
And I hope you can. Yeah.
And I do those things like live close to where I work and such.
Yep, I know you do.
What exactly, I mean, do you feel like any ethical challenges like with regard to, like how I guess is this experience of us being like a linchpin in the fossil fuel fiesta around the world? How is that, the fact that Eau Claire is now kind of somewhat this becoming a part of that, how does that make you feel in terms of how you want to teach your students differently about geology jobs?
I guess as far as that goes, I consider myself an environmentalist. I do not consider myself an environmentalist in what might be considered a Greenpeace sort of a way or a Sierra Club sort of a way. I use materials, and this tabletop is made out of petrochemicals. I have a car, I need steel for that. I have a home, I need wood. So I do not believe that it is possible to just not mine these stuff, not to get oil and natural gas. I believe that if I'm going to use it, then I have to be willing to pay a price for that as well. If somebody is using it, but they say, I'm not willing to pay a price in my backyard, I view that as an untenable position as a geologist. So how do I feel about Eau Claire becoming involved in the oil and natural gas thing? I really wish we could wean ourselves from this stuff, quite frankly. I don't discount greenhouse gases and stuff like that. I wish we could. So as soon as oil and gas prices go up, and once they get to a certain point, then what do people do? They clamor to open up the strategic oil reserve to try and lower gas prices, when exactly what we need in order to reduce oil and natural gas consumption is to have higher prices so that people have an incentive not to use it. I know some people who have more cars than they have people in their family. What on earth? What on earth is that? That's American extravagance to the nth degree. And those cars, they're moving all the time. They're moving all the time. Is that sustainable? Absolutely not. I don't want to be any part of that. I don't. I'm cynical. I am. I don't see a lot of hope with regard to the greenhouse sort of thing. I don't. Because even if we manage things, who are we to tell the developing world that they can't burn their coal? We did it. And we're going to tell them not to? How are we going to give them an incentive to do that? I don't know. We're going to buy them off? Yeah, right. We don't have the money to buy anybody off.
Well, this lively discussion can go on for 24 hours, I'm sure, and I need to break it off. But let's thank Kent Syverson for a